The objective of the Watts Lecture is to bring speakers who will appeal to a broad audience on a topic of wide interest. Our attendance tonight speaks volumes for Dr. Suzuki and his message. It also speaks to the importance our community places on tonight's topic. UTSC is proud to host Dr. Suzuki and We Canada for this important lecture, which highlights UTSC's reputation and focus as a leading center for scholarly research and education in the field of environmental sciences. This is an information-packed evening, so without further delay, let me introduce to you We Canada. We Canada is a youth-led nationwide civil society movement for Canadian leadership in sustainable development. We Canada will have a strong presence at the United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development, also known as the Earth Summit 2012 in Rio de Janeiro. Now, supported by the Canadian Earth Summit Coalition, We Canada now counts 80 young adult volunteers, veteran sustainability advocates, and 30 research, grassroots, and academic organizations across the country that are mobilizing Canadians for the upcoming Earth Summit 2012. Now, We Canada's tour, Dialogue in Action for Earth Summit 2012, started on January 30th of this year in Corner Brook, Newfoundland. Today's event marks the 12th event in a series of events across the country. They've been doing an absolutely terrific job. So far, the tour has included guest speakers such as Climate Reality Canada's founding vice chair and president, Desiree McGraw, Students on Ice founder Jeff Green, and the Brazilian ambassador to Canada, His Excellency Mr. Piragibe dos Santos Tarago. The results from these dialogues held across the country during the tour will be compiled in a report that will be presented at Rio de Janeiro at the conference. And now, it is my pleasure to welcome We Canada co-founder Alexandra Nasteska, who is traveling the country with her colleagues to the UTSC stage at this time. Alexandra.
Hi. There you go. There is always something.
That's what I've learned in these last 12 cities.
Is that good? Thank you. Thank you so much. So, hello everyone. My name is Alexandra Nasteska, and I'm the co-founder of We Canada. I'm currently traveling the country to talk to Canadians about the upcoming United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development, and you'll hear me refer to it as Earth Summit 2012, which is our preferred name, and also Rio Plus 20. Being born and raised in a country that was bordering a conflict zone, and very often a conflict zone itself, for as long as I know about myself, I dreamed of a better world. So I got involved with the United Nations at the age of 14, and back then I was more interested in women's issues. The United Nations for me was a place where we can come together as species and work to solve global problems. The opportunity to work on social and environmental issues at the same time, which is the Earth Summit, or coordinating civil society for the Earth Summit 2012, was another dream that I couldn't pass on. So I joined the team at One Earth, which is a research organization that operates out of Vancouver, in coordinating civil society. We undertook this initiative because we believe that this particular event has the potential to bend history in a new direction towards a bright green future where democracy, transparency, sustainability, and human rights prevail. During this talk, I would like you to think about what is the future you want. So let's take 20 seconds and take a moment, close your eyes, and picture your neighborhood. What does it look like in 2020? What does it look like in 2030? How do you know that a green, economically prosperous, and more socially just future is here? What do you see? In the next 20 minutes, I'm going to tell you about four amazing Canadians that have shaped the global our leadership on the global stage. We're going to go back in time all the way to 1972, and we're going to look at the Canadian role in Earth Summit. And we're also going to talk about the three policy ideas that We Canada is proposing as our national strategy for Rio Plus 20. And we're also going to tell you how you can get involved. So the Earth Summit is regarded as one of the most important global events in sustainable development of our time. We're traveling the country because we want you to know that as Canadians, we have a special role at the summit, a legacy of true global leadership. For example, this here is Maurice Strong. In the lead-up to the Stockholm Conference in 1972, which is the Conference on Human Development, he commissioned the very first report on the state of the human environment. You're going to hear about a lot of firsts today. Under his leadership in 1972, government officials gathered alongside civil society to form the United Nations Environment Program. So this very conference is very important. It put environmental issues on the global agenda. It is regarded as the, it has been recognized as the beginning of modern political and public awareness of global environmental issues. So just for perspective, let's think about 1970s for a second. There was no internet, and people were still organizing and thinking about these things. The first Earth Day was held. They're literally sweeping the ground. And this is what really sticks with me most. There was only 3.8 billion people. So can you imagine thousands and thousands and thousands of years till we hit 3.8 billion, and then bam, 40 years later, we're at 7 billion. Another key moment I'd like you to remember from tonight is the forming of the Brundtland Commission. Basically, what happened in 1972 is world leaders saw the need of forming an organization whose sole purpose was to raise awareness of sustainable development. So the Brundtland Commission was formed, and again, it was Canada that played a vital role by providing substantial financial assistance to the Brundtland Commission. And that over there is Canadian Jim McNeill, who was not only the Secretary General of the Commission, but he was also the primary author of their first report, Our Common Future. This report is a very important report because it gave sustainable development a definition for the very first time that ended up being accepted globally. And as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Flash forward, 1992, the United Nations Conference on Environmental Development was held in Rio de Janeiro, also known as the first Earth Summit. About 190 governments participated, with 108 sending their heads of state. In the lead up to this conference, Canadian Desiree McGraw, at then only 20 years of age, was traveling the country to talk to youth about global peace and security. This very tour got her appointed as one of the two global youth delegates for the conference. And with this, Canadian Desiree McGraw made history as the first youth to ever be included officially formally in the negotiations. The main outcomes of this conference, that's Desiree McGraw. She was actually one of our speakers at the Montreal stop, and she's also a We Canada champion. The main outcomes of this conference were the Rio Declaration, Agenda 21, the Biodiversity Convention, and the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. I'm bringing up these outcomes because they still have an effect on our lives today. One example is the Kyoto Protocol, which came out of the UNFCCC meetings, which we backed out of recently. And this Earth Summit is going to be remembered because of one more Canadian, Severin Kala Suzuki. She spoke at this summit, at the age of 12 in front of 84 heads of state. This speech is currently part of a curriculum in thousands of schools around the world. Her words echo through history to remind us of the dire situation humanity was facing then. So if you ever get a chance to see the speech, I want you to think, can these very words be spoken to heads of state today? 10 years later, Severin Kallis Suzuki got appointed as a member of the high advisory panel of the then Secretary General Kofi Annan, the United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan. So let's see what was happening in Canada for Johannesburg, for the World Summit on Sustainable Development held in Johannesburg 2002. Well, with the support of the government, there was a multi-stakeholder secretariat formed. This secretariat developed a national engagement strategy, which was, there was a web consultation, but there was also 17 roundtable discussions held across the country. And they were looking to truly understand what is it that Canadians want. And they were also looking to reflect this on the global stage. Unfortunately, there was no ratifications at this summit. What was exciting, though, was the emergence of type 2 outcomes, which never happened before. And that's agreements between non-state and non-governmental actors. Basically, civil society said, well, hey, look, it's not only about what the government does. We need to organize, and we can make agreements between ourselves. What was striking at this conference was the lack of leadership on part of developed countries when it comes to global environmental issues such as climate change. And the United States did not send a delegation, which is what they're remembered for when it comes to this summit. So let's flash forward. Another 10 years into the future, the United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development is at our doorstep. The government of Brazil announced about 50,000 participants, and I honestly hope that some of you will be there with us. The topics of the conference are green economy in context of poverty eradication, and the other one is institutional framework on sustainable development. So what is green economy? There are many definitions. It's a buzzword to start with, but there is many definitions out there right now, and none of them is globally adopted. However, the United Nations Environment Program has been taking a lead on defining the green economy as one that results in improved human well-being and social equity while significantly reducing ecological risks and scarcities. So the second topic of the conference is institutional framework on sustainable development. It sounds fancy, but what is it really about? It's about how we manage ourselves, how we govern ourselves at a local, regional, national and global levels to ensure that not only governments are meeting their commitments that they make at this conference, but to also make sure that we're moving towards sustainable development. It is about processes, organizations, and institutions we would like to set up to move towards sustainability. So let me tell you a little bit about We Canada and the Canadian Earth Summit Coalition. In May 2010, One Earth initiated, the organization I mentioned earlier, initiated the forming of the Canadian Earth Summit Coalition. And this is right now a network, informal network of over 30 organizations from across the country. And this is our policy work. Through the Earth Summit, Canadian Earth Summit Coalition, we work on policy. For example, we surveyed these organizations that are right now our partners and many more to find patterns in the conversation with one question in mind. What is it that Canadians can bring to the summit? What is it that we have to bring to the table? We also launched a public campaign that you now know as We Canada, and we're traveling under the banner of We Canada across the country. In November, Canadian Earth Summit Coalition submitted an official position to the United Nations Zero Draft, which is the negotiating document for the Earth Summit. In this submission, the Canadian Earth Summit Coalition included three policy recommendations for the Earth Summit 2012, and they reflect the topics and the objectives of the conference. So let me tell you a little bit about them. The first one is about values. We call it measuring what matters. It's about establishing a better measurement of national progress and well-being. Currently, most nations around the world use GDP, gross domestic product, as a measurement not only of economic progress, but also as an indicator of our collective well-being. However, I believe we all know that GDP does not capture the full range of economic, environmental, and social realities that affect humans. Therefore, we're calling for the government of Canada to continue on this track, and we're calling the government of Canada at Rio to push for the development of global standards for measuring well-being, and they will also reflect social economic costs. So the second policy area we call getting the prices right. Basically, we all know what we pay for things. There is a price. If we like it, we pay. But there is a cost behind the price that we are less aware of. For example, in Canada, we consume an excess of products whose manufacture generates pollution and greenhouse gas emissions. This is partly due to the subsidies that Canada gives to the fossil fuel industries, which results in lower market prices. But even without these subsidies, these prices do not reflect the true costs of our ecological and social costs of the economic activity. Therefore, we are calling for the government of Canada to eliminate fossil fuel subsidies and to put a price on carbon. The third policy area, it's about drawing a straight line between our country's action and its global outcomes. We want our trade to be fair. This means acknowledging that our economic activity has social as well as environmental impacts beyond and way beyond our borders. Therefore, we are calling the government of Canada to incorporate fair trade certified products as a best practice in the federal sustainable development strategy. So, what are your ideas you would like us to bring to Rio Plus 20? Building a better world is not an easy task. As a matter of fact, envisioning Canada's role in the Earth Summit can be very hard. And yet, 20 years ago, people were still doing it. They were consulting the Canadian government was consulting civil society. In 1992, the Canadian government was preparing for Rio Plus 20 for 2.5 years. They held civil society consultations across the country, and they were seeking to understand what do Canadians want and how can we bring that to the global stage. Unlike today, where the Canadian government submitted their national position without incorporating what civil society wants and needs. So back then, it was Canada that was pioneer of civil society participation at United Nations conferences. It was the late Arthur Campeau who brought negotiations to halt by refusing to participate until civil society was brought to the table. And at Rio, it was also Canada that exerted pressure to save the Biodiversity Convention when the United States announced that they were opposing the treaty. So today, we don't have to imagine a solar power world. All the solutions are well within our reach. So what stops us, really? What stopped the government of Canada to talk to civil society when us, 80 volunteers, are doing it? I was born and raised in Macedonia, and immigrating away from a border conflict zone was a long-time dream. And as somebody that comes from a borderline developing country, I know how much we depend on countries like Canada to lead the way. Today, as a proud Canadian citizen, I just can't accept the withering credibility of our country. And nobody should have to do that. We have been running for 18 months solely on volunteer power. We developed the policy recommendations. We're doing a tour across the country. And one of our volunteers, since 2 weeks ago, jumped on a bike, and she's biking from Vancouver all the way to Rio just to raise the awareness of sustainable development and to show the world that Canadians are fair and forward-thinking. I believe there is people like that amongst amongst you here, amongst us tonight. So this is some of the ways you can become part of We Canada. Number one, when you leave this room later, there's going to be, you can sign, you can send the letter to your minister, to the minister, Peter Kent. It's outside these doors. That's going to, people think writing letters does not matter. Well, it actually makes a really big difference, and I heard this from Desiree McGraw. Then you can organize an Earth Summit Dialogue. So outside these doors also there is a sign-up sheet. You can sign up for an Earth Summit Dialogue, and we're gonna provide you with a toolkit. And then the last you can do is you can organize a global action, a Rio Plus 20 Action Day in your community. So my final words. Canada's international position needs to be tied into domestic priorities, to what are our values, interests, and assets as a community. We have to stop learning about foreign policy, or any policy for that matter, through the news. We have to close the gap between what policy is being carried out at the global level and what policy that we want to, as citizens, seeing carried out. And another thing we have to stop is we have to stop being complacent and pessimistic. It's just far too late and things are far too bad to be pessimistic. We have to get angry and we have to get hopeful. After all, we like to say in We Canada, optimism is a political act. When neither silent nor foolish, optimism can be revolutionary. I'm going to quote somebody that inspired me. Canada is a great country, one of the hopes for the world. We can be a better one, a country of greater equality, justice, and opportunity. We can restore our good name in the world. Great movements for change begin with great statements for optimism. We can have the future we want.
Canadians, we live in some of the coldest places on the planet.
But we don't huddle inside.
We make ice a national pastime.
Cool.
A source of comfort. We're home to a guy who ran a few thousand kilometers on one leg.
We built an arm that grabs satellites out of space.
We look at tree sap and think,
that might be great on pancakes.
We put peace before war. Health before profit.
Us before I.
We before me.
We always find a way.
Because we can.
And can is Canadian.
The Earth needs Canada.
Because we always find a way.
And now we'll find ways to make a difference.
We can tell a friend.
Talk to a neighbor.
Or email leaders who represent us, but could do better to reflect us.
We can bring our own mark.
Support fair trade.
Walk instead of drive.
We can design better cities.
Decrease inequality. Create an economy built to last longer than quarter to quarter.
We can create a better world for our children, so one day they're inspired to create a better one for theirs.
We can be a living, breathing example to the rest of the world.
And we can be the voice of change at Earth Summit
2012.
Let's show the world what we can do.
What Canada can do.
We can.
We can.
We can.
We can.
We can.
Canada.
Thank you. So now I'd like to welcome to the stage to introduce Dr. Suzuki, a friend of mine now. Her name is Amber Mack. And when we were still a baby, when We Canada was still a baby and starting out, Amber Mack stepped in to help us out. She's a worldwide known social media strategist. She's also a CTV host for App Central and a best-selling author, Power Friending. So without further ado, Amber, thank you so much for being here with us tonight.
Alex, great job. Great job. One round of applause again. All right, so since I am such a fan of social media, I have to ask, how many Facebook users are in the room? Yeah, quite a few. How many Twitter users? Okay, so since Dr. Suzuki has such an amazing past, I decided to take all of the things that he's done and put it into kind of like a Facebook timeline. That makes sense, right? Yeah. All right, so let's start in 1936. Dr. David Suzuki was born. Yes, this is the first step of the timeline. 1958, he received an honors BA in biology from Amherst College of Massachusetts. 1961, he obtained his PhD in zoology from the University of Chicago. 1963, started working as a professor at UBC. 1971 to 1972, hosted Suzuki on Science, a children's science program. Does anyone remember that? All right. All right, I'm kind of dating myself because I'm starting to remember some of these things. All right, 1979, started hosting The Nature of Things on CBC. Fantastic. Woo! 1990, co-founded the David Suzuki Foundation. 1992, wrote along with his team the Declaration of Independence for UN's Earth Summit in Rio. 2004, tied for fifth place in CBC television poll of greatest Canadians ever. I remember that one. Woo! I say he's number one, but anyway. 2009, received Honorary Right Livelihood Award. 2010, won People's Choice Documentary Award at Toronto International Film Festival for Force of Nature. Now, this is the part that just amazes me when you get down to some of these numbers. He has 27 honorary doctorates, 27. 44 electronic media awards and 15 print media awards. And for his support of Canada's First Nations people, Dr. Suzuki has been honored 6 times and formal adoption by 2 tribes. So that is Dr. Suzuki's, yes, big round of applause. That is Dr. Suzuki's Facebook timeline, but I'm not done yet. One more thing. When it comes to Twitter, I went onto Twitter this afternoon and I asked some of my friends if they could tell me what they thought was so amazing about David Suzuki, and I think we all agree. And this was one of the best tweets that I received, so I want to share it today. I think it's a perfect introduction. This is from Jesslyn Klein, who I don't know, but she wrote this. David Suzuki is a pioneer, driving positive environmental change in a universal way. He is the face of a brighter future. Ladies and gentlemen, let me present David Suzuki.
Okay, there we go. My main concern was with the people in the overflow who wouldn't hear me without this. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to address you. First of all, Alexandra, thank you so much for the passion and explaining what We Canada is all about. I learned tonight, because I'd forgotten, that this is the second time I'm delivering the annual Watts lecture. I'm delighted to be back. I think my hair was black when I came the first time. But I'm especially glad to be here to support We Canada, which is, as you know, a youth-driven initiative aimed at galvanizing a Canadian presence at Rio Plus 20 in June. This is an opportunity, I think, this year to remind ourselves that 20 years ago, the world had recognized that humanity had to pay attention to the ecological consequences of the way that we were acting and living. At Rio in 1992, Canada and Canadians played a prominent role in that meeting. Canada was near the head of the line as a green nation. You should demand, I think, whenever you have people speaking to you, you should demand to know what the speaker's agenda is. And I want to tell you that first. I'm speaking here tonight, not as a representative of the David Suzuki Foundation, but as an individual. I'm here to speak as an elder. And you know, I believe that this is the most important stage in my life. You see, as you get older, your testosterone levels drop. And I've been amazed that now that I don't think about sex every minute of my life, I've suddenly got really smart. Now I know why women were always so far ahead of me for most of my life. But now at this stage in my life, I'm no longer driven by the need for power or fame or money. And it's possible to speak from my heart, as I find young people do, especially children. They speak straight from their hearts, and that's what gives children their power. But as an elder, I have the added thing of a lifetime of experience. So I have no hidden agenda as I speak to you this evening. I am here to displace or to carry out, discharge a heavy responsibility. You see, I grew up as an adult after World War II. My generation, the boomers that followed, have been so caught up in the enormous growth in our economy and change that we've not paid attention to the kind of world we're leaving for generations to come. I am here hoping that we can move to a safer, healthier, more secure future for my grandchildren, and that is my agenda. 20 years ago, the largest gathering up till that time of heads of state ever in history met in Rio to declare that henceforth humanity would never ignore the environment when it came to major decisions and programs and actions. Agenda 21 was a massive blueprint, a blueprint to get humanity onto a road to a truly sustainable future. Agenda 21 would cost the industrialized countries 0.7% of our annual GDPs, a much greater proportion, about 20%, of the GDPs of the poor countries. But even before the month of June in 1992 was over, the rich countries were already saying, we can't afford to pay the cost of Agenda 21. And since Rio, we've seen so many more conferences on biodiversity, on climate. We've seen them in Kyoto, in Bali, in Cancun, in Nagoya, in Montreal, in Copenhagen, and Durban. And they were all doomed to fail. They were doomed to fail because we didn't put the health of the biosphere above our own individual national interests. We fail, I believe, today to recognize what a powerful force humanity has become. And we haven't seen it because it has happened so very suddenly. You know, if a monster came from outer space, landed on the planet, and began to run with such giant feet, they would destroy an acre of rainforest a second and spew out of its rear end toxic chemicals in millions and millions of pounds every year and gobble up huge amounts of the ocean and drink huge amounts of the water. We would declare an international emergency. You can bet that the president of the United States would be calling the president of China and Russia and Iran, and we would all be acting together as a single species against this great enemy. Well, of course, the monster has landed. The monster is here, but it's not an alien from outer space. It's us. And I believe that despite the urgent warnings of scientists now for over 40 years that we are headed down a very dangerous path, we're not really aware of the immensity of the problem because it has happened as a transformation of our species so very suddenly. You see, for most of human history, we were a local tribal animal. We were nomadic hunter-gatherers following, moving across the planet, following game and plants through the seasons. We didn't care whether there were other people living across a desert, over a mountain, or on the other side of the ocean. We only cared about our tribal territory and our tribe. We knew throughout time that we were deeply embedded in nature and utterly dependent on nature for our well-being and survival. The agricultural revolution that began 10,000 years ago signaled a profound change, the beginning of a profound change in the way that we lived. A radical shift to a non-nomadic hunter-gatherer to sedentary farming. But even in 1900, when there were only 1.5 billion human beings in the world, there were only 14 cities with more than a million people. The vast majority of human beings around the world lived in rural village communities because we were still an agricultural animal. Most of us were involved in some aspect of farming. And farmers know very well we are utterly dependent on the seasons, on weather and climate. Farmers know that we need insects to pollinate flowering plants. Farmers know that certain species of plants can take nitrogen from the air and fix it as fertilizers in the earth. Farmers understand that we are deeply embedded in and utterly dependent on nature. But now we have undergone an unbelievably profound shift in the way that we live. In only 100 years, from 1900, we went from 1.5 billion to 6 billion people by the year 2000. But by the year 2000, 14 cities of more than a million had grown to more than 400 cities. In 1900, the largest city in the world was London with 6.5 million. Tokyo was the seventh largest city with 1.5 million people. By the year 2000, the 10 largest cities in the world all had more than 11 million people. Tokyo was the largest with 26 million people. Can you imagine Tokyo went from 1.5 million to 26 million in only 100 years? And if you've ever been to Tokyo, you know human beings never developed to live that way. Greater Tokyo today has more people than live in all of Canada. We have now, and in Canada, over 80% of us now live in big cities. So in only 100 years, we've been transformed from an agricultural creature to a big city dweller. And in a big city, our sense of who we are and where we belong changes. We live in a human-created environment now, and it's easy to think our intelligence allows us to create our own habitat. So as long as we have a few parks out there where we can go and camp and play in the summer, who needs nature? We don't need nature. We build our own habitat, and we build our own surroundings. In a city, well, I should tell you, I have a friend who lives in the northern part of Toronto who tells me that he lives in a high-rise apartment that is completely air-conditioned. And he goes down in the morning, he goes down the elevator into the basement, into his car, which is air-conditioned, and travels down the Don Valley Freeway to a commercial building, into the basement, and up to his office, which is completely air-conditioned. His office is connected through tunnels to huge shopping areas and food markets. He said, "You know, David, I don't have to go outside for weeks." Who needs nature when you live that way? And so in a city, our highest priority becomes our jobs, because we need a job to make money to buy the things that we think we need. So it's not surprising then that our focus begins to shift from understanding we are a part of nature and dependent on nature to feeling that the economy is our highest priority and concern. And we forget the fact that the very word economy comes from the same word as ecology. Ecos is the Greek word meaning household or domain, or what native people would call Mother Earth, our home. Ecology is the study of our home. Economics is the management of our home. What ecologists try to do is determine what are the conditions, the principles, the laws that govern a species' ability to survive and flourish. Not a bad bit of information. You would have thought any corporation, any government, any individual, before beginning a new program or activity, would say, wait, what are those ecologists telling us? because we don't want to do anything that will violate the very conditions and principles that allow us to have a sustainable future. But no, we live in a time when the Prime Minister of Canada says we can't reduce greenhouse gas emissions the way climatologists are telling us we have to. It'll destroy the economy. So we now have elevated the economy above the very atmosphere that sustains all of us. Hermann Scheer, a man I have great admiration for, who died unexpectedly last year, was an economist. He was a politician, and he is considered the father of the whole renewable energy program in Germany, the fastest growing area in the economy in Germany. He was the father of the feed-in tariff, which was a mechanism that encouraged the development of renewable energy policy, which is what Mr. McGuinty has brought in with the Green Energy Plan here in Ontario. And what Hermann told me a few years ago was that the obstacle to moving towards a green future is not technological. It is not political. It is not economic. The major obstacle is psychological. It has to do with the way that we see the world we live in. This year, human beings reached 7 billion people. That's an astounding number. There has never been a mammalian species numbering 1 billion on the planet. We are the only creature that has ever achieved that number. And we are violating a biological principle that the population, the maximum population of a species, is inversely related to its size. In other words, the bigger you are, the fewer there can be. If you're a whale or an elephant, it takes a lot of area and food and everything to keep you going so that the planet can't sustain as many of you, whale or elephant, as it can a mouse or a rat or a rabbit. So there's an inverse relationship between a species number, maximum number, and size. Humans have now transgressed that biological principle. We have done it through trade and through technology, so that we have now increased beyond anything that could have been imagined for any other mammalian species. We are the most numerous mammal on the planet by far, by orders of magnitude, above any other species. And just the fact of living, every one of us has to breathe air. We have to drink water, eat food, clothe and shelter ourselves. Just the act of living, because there are so many of us, means that we have a very heavy ecological footprint. That is, it takes a lot of air, water and land to support our species. But of course, we're not like a rat or a mouse or a rabbit. We have an enormous amount of technology used on our behalf. I look out here, I see a lot of people wearing clothes. I'm sure none of you is growing a huge field of cotton plants in your backyard to grow cotton, or a huge flock of sheep to get your wool from. We are all benefiting from the enormous amount of technology that allows us to take material, to take raw materials from around the world, to manufacture them, and ultimately for us to buy it and use it. Technology, virtually all of the technology that we take for granted today, has been developed within the last 150 years. It's truly remarkable, from planes and cars and trains to light bulbs and electricity to computers and so on. That has amplified our ecological footprint beyond anything that this planet has ever known to come from a species. And it doesn't end there. Ever since the end of World War II, we've been afflicted with an incredible appetite for stuff. We love to shop. I saw a survey that 95% of American teenage girls consider shopping their number one recreation. It's the way they get their exercise, is to go shopping. And all of that material, that the stuff that we buy, comes out of the earth, comes out of the biosphere, and when we're finished with it, we will throw it back into the into the earth. I've just come back from 8 days in the Galapagos Islands, this magnificent ecosystem that's 97% of it is protected as National Park of Ecuador. And on one of the days we went to the beach, and we were shocked to see it covered with plastic, which of course the albatrosses and fish are all eating. And so we gathered up, there were just 16 of us, we gathered up this immense pile of plastic debris because we're using the planet's oceans as a garbage can. There, you can't escape the debris of human activity now anywhere on the planet. And our consumptive demand then adds to our ecological footprint. And we now have a global economy that uses the entire planet as a source of raw materials, the entire planet to dump its toxic wastes and chemicals into the air, water, and soil. And when you the problem with the global economy is that it hides the ecological footprint of the products that we buy. When you go out to buy a cotton t-shirt, I'm sure very few of us ever say, oh, is this organic? Cotton is one of the most chemically intensive crops you can imagine. And if you look at what happened with the Soviet experiment to turn the middle of Asia into the largest cotton growing area in the world around the Aral Sea, you'll see an absolute ecological and social disaster. But we don't see that. We just want a t-shirt, we buy it, and we put it on, and don't understand the ecological and social impact of purchasing that shirt. In the same way, if you buy a car, a TV, or a computer, very few of us would ever say, gee, where do all the metals in these products come from? Mining is one of our most destructive activities. We don't ask, what was the effect of mining for this, all of the metal parts in this car? Where did they come from? And what about the effect on the people in the area? We just want a good car, we pay our money, and we buy it. So the global economy hides the ecological footprint of all of the products that it sends around the world. So when you add these things together, our numbers, our technology, our consumption, and a global economy, we have become a very powerful force. There has never been in the 4 billion years that life has existed on Earth, there has never been a single species able to alter the very physical, chemical, and biological properties of the planet as we are doing today. That's why the Nobel Prize winner, Paul Crutzen, has said, you know, you can divide the ages of the Earth into different periods or epochs based on the geological events that have taken place. The Eocene, the Miocene, the Holocene, and so on. And he said the last 200 years should be called the Anthropocene epoch, the age of man. And that's not man in a gender sense, but human beings. This is a time when our species has become a geological force. And part of the consequence of that is that we are undermining the very life support systems of the planet, the air, the water, and the soil. We live in a world that is shaped by laws that are revealed by scientists. Physics reveals that there is a limit on how fast we can travel. I know the CERN reaction, or CERN results, people say, oh, you can go 7 kilometers faster than the speed of light. I'm still an agnostic or a skeptic on that. But we know that there are limits to the speed that you can ultimately travel. We know that gravity, law of gravity, means you can't have an anti-gravity machine on Earth. We know that the first and second law of thermodynamics means that we cannot build a perpetual motion machine. These are laws of physics we understand. They set the world that we live in, the limits, and we live within that. In chemistry, there are laws that, of the atomic properties of each element, the diffusion rates and reaction constants, that dictate the kind of chemical reactions we can induce in test tubes, the kind of molecules that we can build as a result. Those are laws of chemistry, and we live with them. And in biology, there are principles. We know that we have an absolute need for air, for water, for food that comes from the soil, and for sunlight that is our source of energy, and a diverse array of plants and animals on the planet. We absolutely have to have those things in order to survive and flourish. Those are principles that emerge from biology. So we live in a world, we know that that's the way we have to live because that's the way physics, chemistry, and biology dictate. Other things, though, borders that we draw around our cities, our provinces, our countries, those are not forces of nature. We created them. Other things, capitalism, currency, markets, corporations, the economy, these are not forces of nature. We invented them. And if we invented them, we can change them. And yet we've come now to think that these things are so important. You know, we go to war, we will kill and die to protect the borders that we draw around our property. But you know what? I have never heard of a plant or animal that came screeching to a halt and said, oh, I can't go any further, I'm a Canadian plant, or I'm a Canadian bird or a grizzly bear. Nature doesn't give two hoots about our borders. Air, water, they don't care where they flow according to their own principles and laws. But boy, do we take these laws and or these borders seriously. And it's the same thing with our constructs. My God, we're falling down before the economy now. I was talking to Preston Manning once, and it was a decent conversation until I said, well, the markets, the minute I said markets, it was like, oh, the markets, hallelujah, praise the markets, free the markets, let the markets do their thing. Wait a minute now, we invented the goddamn thing. The market isn't something that emerged out of nature. And people say, look at me, and they go, oh, you're crazy. You know, corporations aren't people. And yet corporations are funding political campaigns. Corporations are now regarded as human beings, for God's sakes. No, corporations are not people. And corporations have no right to be a part of the electoral process. That's for us as members of the public. It wasn't long ago, you know, when people believed in dragons and demons and monsters. I mean, they really believed they were real. I mean, if we thought they were pissed off at us, man, you'd throw jewels and gold and sacrifice virgins and anything to keep them from. No, really. I mean, people were really scared. Well, now we know that they're a figment of our imagination. Nobody believes in dragons or demons or monsters. But what do? We substitute something else called the economy. And just look at the newspapers. Oh, the economy's not looking too healthy today. Man, do we get scared. I mean, we'll throw gold at them or silver jewelry. Can't find any virgins, but we'll find other things to throw. Please, economy, please, please. We invented the damn thing, and we can change them. Now, there are people that think that's crazy. Well, we've already done it before in the past. As World War II was drawing to an end, politicians realized they were going to win, the Allies were going to win the war, but what do you do in a war-torn world? Especially with Japan and Europe, Germany, being virtually flattened, what do we do in a peacetime situation? And so politicians and economists, led by John Maynard Keynes from Britain, met at Bretton Woods in Maine, and hammered out the post-war economy. They tied global currency to the American greenback because it was by far the most powerful economy in the world. They set up the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, and it worked. Japan, Germany emerged as two of the strongest economies in the world very quickly. But they left out nature. They forgot that nature is kinda important, that there are services nature performs and we act as if it doesn't matter. You see all the resistance to putting a price on carbon because we wanna use the atmosphere for free. We don't wanna pay to put anything into it. And the same with pollutants into rivers and into the soil. We don't wanna pay for that. And yet it is nature ultimately that is going to cleanse itself to get rid of these these things, and we don't include that in our economy. So we've got to change, because otherwise we're going to see over and over again what happened in Copenhagen. 2 years ago, 192 countries gathered in Copenhagen to deal with the atmosphere that doesn't belong to anyone, but deal with the atmosphere through 192 national boundaries and 192 economic systems and priorities. And we then tried to take nature and shoehorn nature into human constructs and priorities. It can never work. And that's the same with Rio plus 20. If we don't understand that we have to look at the world a different way. If all we do at Rio is bicker over, well, my country is this and my priorities are this, and how do we trade that against your priorities? It's simply not going to work. You see, the problem is perceptual. We now see the world through what are called anthropocentric lenses. We're at the center of everything, and everything else is out there around us. By the way, Amanda, is it Amanda?
Amber.
The one mistake you made is, we, in 1992, we wrote a declaration of interdependence, not independence. We deliberately chose that way of phrasing it, to show that everything is interconnected. If we live in an anthropocentric world in which everything is there around us, then you get the situation where people talk about the triple bottom line. Triple bottom line is the environment, society, and the economy. And they're generally depicted with as circles, all of equal size, and where they all intersect or overlap, all three of them, that's the sweet spot. That's where you can act and derive benefits for all three, the triple bottom line: environment, society, and the economy. This is the most ludicrous notion I can imagine. It's what gets us into the problem. You see, the reality is that the real world is one great big circle, and that's the biosphere. That's the zone of air, water, and land where all life exists. And within that big circle are 10 million circles of varying sizes. And that's the 10 million species, it may be 30 million, I don't know, but that occupy the biosphere. But if we look at it today, one circle is 40% of that big circle, and that's us. We are now co-opting 40% of what's called the net primary productivity of the planet. That's the total amount of synthetic photosynthetic activity we have co-opted for us. That's the source of all the energy for the whole planet, is that photosynthetic activity. We've taken over 40% of it. So this one circle of ours is already way, way too big. And within that big circle, which is society, there should be a much smaller circle, and that's the economy. And already our economy has expanded so much, it wants to take over and be the same size as the species and the biosphere. That's ridiculous. So we've got to see the world through what is called a biocentric view, a way of seeing that we're a part of a wonderful web of living things, and that our very survival and well-being depends on the health and well-being of the rest of nature that resides in the planet. So the challenge then is, we've got to see the world as it really is. And that is not at the center of things, not separate from the rest of the environment, but deeply embedded in it. And the way I illustrate this is by basically giving a scientific view of what I've been taught by First Nations people in Canada. First Nations refer to the Earth as Mother Earth, and when I first heard that, I thought, well, that's a good way of saying it. And they said, look, you don't understand. We're not speaking poetically or metaphorically. We mean it literally. The Earth is our mother because it gives birth to us through the four sacred elements: earth, air, fire, and water. It took me a while to figure out what they meant, and I realized they are absolutely right. You see, what is the very first thing that every baby on the planet needed when it's left its mother's body? Well, of course, the answer is a breath of air. That breath, the first breath, was to inflate its lungs and to announce to the world, I have arrived. And from that moment on, 15 to 40 times a minute, we need air. And we need that air till the last breath we take before we die. And we don't even think about it. I want you to think for the next minute, think about that simple act that we do from our birth to death. Through 2 to 3 liters of air deep down into the most intimate, moist, warm parts of our bodies, our lungs. If you've ever seen the fresh lungs of an animal and touched them, you know, it's kind of mushy, squishy. It's a really funny texture. And the reason for that is lungs are mainly made of air. Our lungs have about 300 million alveoli, little capsules clustered like grapes around a stem, and we need 300 million of them to provide the surface area to come into contact with each breath of air. If you flattened out all the alveoli in our lungs, they would cover a tennis court. That's how much surface area is all wrinkled up in our lungs. And each alveolus is lined with a three-layered membrane called a surfactant. The surfactant reduces surface tension, so when the air hits it, it instantly sticks or fuses. Carbon dioxide rushes out. Oxygen and whatever else is in the air rushes in. Hemoglobin molecules and red blood cells grab onto the oxygen, and with each beat of our hearts, that oxygen is pumped to all the parts of our bodies. And when you exhale, you don't exhale everything in your lungs. If you did that, your lungs would collapse. About half of the air stays in your lungs with each breath. So the point I'm making is there is no line that says, the air ends here and I begin there. There is no line. It's in us, it's stuck to us, and it's circulating through our bodies. We are air. It's not that air is out there and I am here. We are air. It's in us. It's a part of who we are. And of course, with each breath, the air that does come out of my nose goes straight up your nose. Well, not straight up. It goes straight up your noses and then gradually spreads through the room, and you'll all be breathing that one breath that I took a few minutes before. When I say this, when there are children in the audience, I always see a few kids go, oh, yeah. I guess they think they have a little bubble of air that belongs to them. And there's a wonderful thought exercise the American astronomer Harlow Shapley did it many years ago. He said, I want to follow one breath of air. How do you follow a breath of air? 98% of air is oxygen and nitrogen. Breathe it in, oxygen and nitrogen go into your body, breathe it out. A lot of the oxygen doesn't come back out. That's why we need air every minute. Some of the nitrogen reacts in our bodies and doesn't come out. But 1% of the air is an element called argon. And anybody who's taken chemistry knows argon belongs to a group of elements called the noble gases. They're so snooty and they think they're so hot, they don't go in for that physical chemical stuff. They don't react chemically with anything. They're chemically inert. So you breathe it in, goes into your body, breathe it out, comes right back out. So argon is a good marker for a breath of air. It's 1% of the air. How many atoms of argon in one breath of air? Shapley calculates 3 times 10 to the super 18. That's 3 followed by 18 zeros. So on that basis, imagine Alexandra breathes out one breath of air. Within minutes, we're all breathing gazillions of argon atoms from that one original breath, but the doors are open. Eventually, that entire breath will go out of the building, across the campus, across Ontario, around the world. And according to Shapley, 1 year later, no matter where you are, because air is a single system, every breath you take will have about 15 argon atoms from that one original breath she took a year before. So on that basis, and then when you calculate the carbon dioxide that comes out of your breath, every breath will suffuse every needle and every leaf on every tree around the planet. We are deeply connected. Every breath we take has argon atoms that were once in the bodies of Joan of Arc and Jesus Christ. Every breath we take has argon atoms that were in the bodies of dinosaurs 65 million years ago. Every breath we take will suffuse life forms as far as we can see into the future. So air surely is a substance that should be regarded as sacred. It gives life to us. It connects us to the past and into the future. We say we're intelligent. What intelligent creature, knowing the role that air plays, would then proceed to use air as a toxic dump? We are air. Whatever we do to the air, we do directly to ourselves. And the same applies for the other elements: earth, air, fire, and water. Every one of us is at least 60% water by weight. We're just a big blob of water with enough organic thickener added so we don't dribble away on the floor. But of course, you know, we leak water all the time. It comes out of our skin and our eyes and our mouth and our crotch, and we lose water all the time. Well, if I take a drink of water, do you think this is Scarborough water? I mean, you know the hydrologic cycle that water cartwheels around the planet. And wherever you get your water, it contains molecules that have evaporated off every ocean on the planet, off the canopies of every forest. We are water, and water is like air. It's a glue that connects us all together. We say we're intelligent. What intelligent creature, knowing we are water, would then proceed to use water as a place to dump our garbage and toxic chemicals? We are the earth because every bit of the food that we eat for our nutrition was once alive, and most of it was plants grown on the soil. We are the earth through the food that we consume. And we are fire because every bit of the energy in our bodies that we need to move and grow and reproduce, all of that is sunlight. Sunlight captured by plants, converted into chemical energy, and we then eat the plants or eat the animals that eat the plants and store that energy in our bodies. So when you think of the earth as our mother, it is true. We are created by those sacred elements that connect us to all of each other. In the name of economic growth, we are now using up finite resources and spewing our wastes into the air, water, and soil, and leaving problems. And I think this is a part that really hurts me, makes me feel very, very guilty, that my generation and the others that have followed have not thought about the long-term consequences. We are going to mine and use up the tar sands in Alberta. That's a one-time shot of using this vast deposit of fossil fuel. And by using it up for our purposes now, we deprive future generations of an opportunity to exploit that in other ways. We deprive future generations of the opportunity to reap the economic benefits of that resource. We don't give a damn about future generations. You know what economists do? They discount the value of coming generations, because they assume, oh, well, there'll be inflation and technological progress. So, yeah, we've really screwed up the atmosphere with too much carbon. But by the time you guys are growing up, well, you know, it won't cost that much because of inflation, really. And we'll have invented some kind of technology to take care of it. That, I think, is simply wrong. And it's something that we've got to overcome. It's the reason why I was so galvanized when I first heard about We Canada, because it is youth that has the greatest stake in what we do or do not do in the coming years. We need to develop, there are a number of things that we have to do to bring this runaway economic system under control. As Alexander mentioned, you know, the GDP is the measurement to indicate that politicians will turn somersaults trying to keep the GDP growing. But the GDP is one of the nuttiest measuring tools that you can imagine. The GDP measures any transaction of money for goods and services. Doesn't matter why you're paying money, just any transaction is added to the GDP. Never subtracts. So let's take a really extreme scenario here. We have this ludicrous situation of the largest nuclear plant in Canada next to the largest city of Toronto. But no, we're assured by the can-do people, no, this technology, it's safe, it's foolproof. You know, we're not stupid like those Russians or like those Japanese. We've got a foolproof technology. Well, have you ever thought of what a foolproof technology is? It's a technology free of fools. I mean, that's what the word says. Now, who among us has never fallen in love and lost 50 IQ points? Who among us hasn't gone out and got hammered one night and come into work half hungover or caught the flu and come into work? All kinds of things make us act as fools at some point. There is no such thing as a foolproof technology unless you get rid of the fools, which is what Hal recognized in the movie 2001. Get rid of the people and maybe the mission will succeed. So let's suppose that these safe reactors in Darlington have an accident and vent a massive cloud of radioactivity that floats over the city of Toronto, and hundreds of people come down with radiation sickness. Well, you know, economists think that's great. You're going to need ambulances, you're going to need doctors and nurses, and no doubt hire a lot of lawyers. All of that adds to the GDP. And then if dozens of people begin to die of radiation poisoning, well, you need grave diggers and hearses and flowers and caskets. All of that adds to the GDP. And then if you say, okay, Darlington, you're going to have to clean up that mess. It's going to cost you billions of dollars. That goes on to the GDP as well. So what is obviously an ecological and a social disaster by a GDP measurement, whoa, the GDP suddenly shot up a tremendous amount. What a nutty idea that this is what we're going to use as an indicator of well-being of anything. This has got to be... So we need a new kind of indicator, what Peter Victor at York University calls a prosperity index, where prosperity isn't measured just in terms of dollars and cents. There are whole other aspects of what it is to be prosperous. We need to have a steady state economy. We can't have an economy that is endlessly growing. Nothing in a finite world can grow forever. But because we seem to be committed to the idea that our very well-being depends on keeping the economy growing, nobody ever asks, are there no limits? How much is enough? Are we happier with all this stuff? What is an economy for? These are really important questions. But we just seem to blindly believe what our politicians are telling us. We got to do everything we can to keep that economy growing. It simply is not possible for it to grow endlessly. And I'm sorry, I know some of you have seen my thing that the NFB did about exponential growth on YouTube. But I really want you to understand why it's craziness to keep thinking we can have an economy that grows forever. The Brundtland Commission report that came out in 1987 that coined the phrase sustainable development still predicted or looked to a fivefold increase in the economy. Never questioned the need to keep growing. Sir Nicholas Stern, the economist who estimated the cost of not doing anything to meet climate change, still thinks the economy, and he's a great guy, I love Nick, but he still thinks the economy's got to keep growing forever. I'm going to show you why this is crazy. Anything growing steadily over time is called exponential growth. And anything growing exponentially has a predictable doubling time. Okay? So if it's growing at 1% per year, it'll double in 70 years. 2% per year will double in 35 years. 3%, 24 years. 4%, 17 and a half years. Anything growing exponentially has a predictable doubling time. I'm going to give you a system analogous to the Earth, and that's a test tube full of food for bacteria. That's the Earth. And I'm going to put one bacterial cell in, that's us, and it's going to start dividing exponentially every minute. Okay, so at time zero at the beginning, there's one cell. 1 minute, there are two. 2 minutes, there are four. 3 minutes, eight. 4 minutes, 16. That's exponential growth. And at 60 minutes, the test tube is completely full of bacteria and no food. So when is the test tube only half full? Well, of course, he answers it, 59 minutes. It's half full, but 1 minute later, it'll be filled. So at 58 minutes, it's 25% full. 57 minutes, it's 12.5% full. At 55 minutes of a 60-minute cycle, it's 3% full. So if at 55 minutes, one of the bacteria said, guys, I've been thinking, we got a population problem. The other bacteria would say, Jack, what the hell have you been smoking, man? 97% of the test tube's empty, and we've been around for 55 minutes. They'd be 5 minutes away from filling it. So bacteria know smarter than people. 59 minutes, they go, oh my God, Jack was right. The hell are we going to do now? You know, how do you create any more air or water or soil? Or how can you, the test tube is everything. And they'd be 1 minute away from filling it. Every scientist I've talked to agrees with me, we've already passed the 59th minute. So all of this need to keep growing is saying we've got to accelerate what is a suicidal path. Now, when I give this talk to business people and politicians, they get mightily angered at me. How dare you say we're past the 59th minute? Look at our stores, they're filled with stuff. Look at our people, we're living longer, we're healthier. Who can say that we're past the 59th minute? I say so without apology. We are creating the illusion that everything's all right by using up the future for our children and grandchildren. Just talk to any elder who's lived in an area for 60 or 70 or 80 years. What was it like here when you were a kid? All over the world, elders answer the same thing. It used to be so different. There used to be trees as far as you could see. The skies used to be dark with birds at certain times of the year. The rivers used to be jammed with fish. All over the world, our elders are a living record of enormous changes that have happened in the span of a single life. And we think that's progress, but we are using up the future for our children. So let me end with a couple of stories. The first is, in the 1990s, before Hong Kong reverted to China, there was a lot of money coming out of Hong Kong being invested in Canada. And Tara and I have lived in the same house for 35 years. We love this place. It's right on the ocean, downtown Vancouver. And I got a letter in the mail that said, offshore money is pouring into Vancouver. Now is a good time for you to sell and buy up. I'd never heard the term buy up. Never occurred to me you buy a starter home and then you gradually accumulate something bigger and bigger. And it was really angered me because I felt that we didn't have a piece of property or real estate. This is our home. So I thought, okay, if I'm going to put my house, my home on the market, what would I put down as the things that really give it its value to me? And the first thing I put down is the fact that when we bought the house, I moved my wife's mother and father in upstairs. And they've lived with us for 35 years, and both of my children have had grandma and granddad upstairs all their lives. And I put that down as something of great value. When we got married, my father was a cabinet maker, and he built a kitchen cabinet for our apartment. And when we bought the house, I ripped the kitchen cabinet out and put it in our house. Looks like hell. But every time I use that kitchen cabinet, my father is there. And my children have brought in dead snakes and birds and animals off the roads. And we have a little animal cemetery under the dogwood tree. And I put that down. And when my mother died, I put my mother's ashes onto a beautiful clematis plant along the back fence. And every year when that clematis plant blooms, I know that my mother is there. And I put that down. And as I put those things down on the list, I realized those are the things that make our house our home. And those to us are things that are priceless. But on the market, they are absolutely worthless. And that's the problem. We live in a world in which the things that really matter to us are worthless in our economic system. And yet we look to the economy to define those things of value to us. And the other story I want to tell is my great teacher and mentor, the great person in my life, was my father. And in 1994, he was dying. He was not in pain. He knew he was dying. He was not afraid. And I moved in to live with him in the last month of his life. And that was one of the happiest months I ever spent with my father. We talked and laughed and cried. And every night my wife would bring the children with slides of trips we'd taken with my dad. And when she came in, he'd say, "And what wonderful trip are we going on tonight?" And in all that time I was with him, the last month, He never once said, David, do you remember that closet full of fancy clothes I had? He never once said, do you remember that 1988 Chev I bought or that house in London, Ontario where we lived? All he talked about were family, friends, and neighbors and the things we did together. And he said over and over again, David, I die a wealthy man. His wealth was in people and the relationships and experiences he'd had with them. And I realized those at the end of his life were all that mattered. We've got off on some weird, weird idea that having stuff is what makes us happy, that what is life is all about, and it's not. So this is, I think, the challenge we face. Again, I want to say how grateful I am to be a part of the campaign that We Canada has undergone here. Please, they're doing it on next to nothing. There are boxes at the back of the room. Please, for the price of one hamburger, you'll feel good if you just put something in the box and contribute to the We Canada venture. This is a very, very important project. Thank you very much. Do we have time for questions? Okay. Is it possible to get some lights on in here where I can't see, like on the audience? Is that possible? So Malcolm, are you going to tell the audience what's...
I am. Just make ourselves at home here a little bit. So, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Malcolm Campbell. I'm the Vice Principal of Research here at University of Toronto Scarborough, and it gives me great pleasure to spend the next couple of minutes with Dr. Suzuki taking your questions. The way that we're going to do that is honoring the social media age. And if you take your card that you used as your entry ticket this evening and a pen and write your question on the back of that card, people on the sides will take your card and bring it up to me. Now, the questions that are going to fare best are those that are formulated in the form of a tweet, so 140 characters or less. It'll make my job a lot easier and let us move along through a fair number of questions. And for those of you who are in the overflow rooms, we're doing exactly the same thing there. We will be taking your questions and they will be transmitted to me on this device right here. So I'll be taking questions that way as well. And if you really want to get my attention, you can also tweet me. So we'll be taking questions as well through the hashtag UTSCWATS. So with no further ado, I will join Dr. Suzuki. That was a great talk. Thank you ever so much. And I would say, for those of you who don't know me as well, I'm a geneticist by training and have a great passion for the environment. But I will tell you, sitting up here right now, this is very much like having a failed Jedi sitting with Obi-Wan Kenobi. So while we're gathering questions, I'll pose one myself. So this is your second Watts lecture. You were here 27 years ago.
Wow, really?
That's right. So probably older than, or longer.
So I must have talked genetics back then.
It was probably exactly what you talked about. So what I'd like you to do is to project yourself forward 27 years for your hat trick lecture in the Watts series. And casting your mind forward, what is it that you think you'll say to us in 27 years?
I won't be here in 27 years.
Oh, you'll only be 102 years old.
No, I don't even. And the one thing I've learned is that putting a time limit on things is a very dangerous thing. I remember when a man named Bruno Mansur came out of Borneo. And he said the Penan were in imminent danger of losing their hunter-gathering way of life because the logging was going on. We had 1 year to stop the logging. Well, we went roaring around raising money and saying, we've got 1 year, 1 year. 1 year came and went, and the challenge was still there. And it was, so a lot of people were disappointed that we didn't achieve what we wanted in a year. I started the David Suzuki Foundation in 1990 because the World Watch Institute in the States had said, this is a turnaround decade. We've got 10 years. If we don't get society on a different path, it'll be too late. Well, it's over 20 years later, and we're still fighting the same fight. 27 years, I have no idea. I first became aware of how serious climate change was in 1988 when I went to Australia for the first time, and scientists showed me the data. And we've been going backwards since then. So I shudder to think what we're doing. Look at Canada. We've gone back to the Middle Ages, the Stone Ages, as far as our environmental attitude goes on the part of our federal government. We're going way backwards. So the next 27 years, I think, are going to be surprise after surprise.
Well, in keeping with that, the first question that I've received here is one that's related to that. You've mentioned one solution that you've come up with yourself, which is the David Suzuki Foundation. The PXLXO asks, what are some solutions to the problems that Dr. Suzuki has given attention to in your lecture? So you've given us one solution. What are other solutions?
Well, I think that what we need now desperately is more democracy. We have a government in place that got 40% of the vote. And I think the progressives in the country have really got to come together because, in fact, we need to bring the attention of the government to the need for serious action. There are lots of things we can do as individuals. You know, then you can buy books, 100 Ways to Save the Planet, 10 Easy Ways to da, da, da. It's not going to be easy. And yes, we've all got to begin to change the way we live. But we really need big decisions. We need laws passed. We need regulations and enforcement. And that means we have to have the federal will for that. So I urge young people to talk to the two most important people on the planet, your mom and dad. And tell mom and dad you're really concerned. Right now, politicians, when they get elected, the first priority is to get reelected. And that means whatever they do has to pay off within that interval between elections. And for the last 4 years, it's been 1 year, 1 year at a time. Young people don't vote. Young people are not on the political agenda. So through your parents, you've got to start raising the future of young people and making that a part of the political discussion. I believe that the biggest thing we need in Canada is more democracy. And that democratic government that represents us, Mr. Harper is my prime minister, damn it. He's not the prime minister of Calgary. He's a Canadian prime minister. And we've got to get him to start acting like that.
It's a great answer. So moving on to another related question. You've already provided some excellent advice for youth with regards to voting. Adrian DeLeon asks, what advice can you give to an undergraduate student who aspires to do something in the environment, or for the environment?
Well, one of the most common questions I'm asked by young people is, how do I go about making a difference? I want to do something to save the planet. Well, first of all, the planet's not in trouble. The planet is going to do fine with or without us. The question is, will the biosphere be able to support us as we want? But my answer is, environmentalism is not a profession or a discipline. Environmentalism is a way of seeing our place on the planet. Follow your heart. Do the things that you love to do and are good at, because that's where you're going to make a difference. But do whatever you do through the lenses of environmentalism. In other words, we need garage mechanics. We need plumbers. We need teachers and doctors. We need musicians and artists. Everybody has got to see the world through the biocentric way of living and make whatever they do as green as it's possible to do it. So don't think of it as a discipline or profession.
Excellent. We've got a question from the overflow room here, AA112, and it's Nancy who's asking, how do we get rid of the economy when we become so dependent upon it?
Well, I mean, that's the big change. There's a very interesting movement called Transition Town that started in the United States, which is aimed at trying to become much more self-sufficient at the local level. I think the unit of survival into the future is going to be local community. So even in Tokyo, I see that there are groups trying to invent a sense of community within greater Tokyo of 35 million people. We need to discover a sense of place, of community, where we live, work, and play together. And I believe that that's the long-term unit of survival. It means being much more local in terms of making things, in terms of food, and the whole locavore movement, the whole organic food movement, all of this, I think, is towards a more sustainable future at the local level. But if you think that Walmart's is sustainable, you're dreaming big time. If you think that we're going to go into a future, and I think a lot of environmentalists think, well, if we can only ramp down our energy demands and have green energy, that we'll be able to live the way we are now. I'm afraid it's simply not possible. We live in such an unequal way with the rest of the world. We, 20% of the population in the industrialized world, use over 80% of the planet's resources. And then we love to say, oh, it's those brown, black, and yellow people, they're breeding like flies. Wait a minute now, they're 80% of the world's population and we leave them a pittance of 20%. We are the hyper-consumers. If you think that we can afford iPad 6s and iPad 10s and all that stuff, and that's what's going to go on, forget it. Not possible, and it's not right for us to do that. So we've got to live much more simply and focus much more on community, I think.
So this question is turning from Canada to the world at large, and Bimo Chan asks, many developing countries would completely agree with the need to help protect nature, but have no economic ability to do so. How do they progress?
Well, I think that we in the rich countries have got to start giving money. I've just come back from Ecuador. Ecuador's great pride is a national forest, a national park called Yasuni National Park, which is in the headwaters of the Amazon River. And it is considered one of the most biodiverse areas in the world. In 1 acre of Yasuni, there are more tree species than all of North America. And this is 1 million acres, the park, with another 2 million acres around it they're trying to protect. They have discovered a massive deposit of oil under Yasuni. So here is Ecuador, a very poor country, and they have said, we are going to leave it in the ground, because we don't want to destroy the forest above by digging it up. And besides, if we burn that, that just adds more to climate change. We're going to leave it in the ground if the rest of the world will pay us half the value of the oil that we leave in the ground. That'll be about $1.5 billion, which would go into a fund. They've already raised $125 million. That will go into a fund that will be used indefinitely, living off the interest, to feed renewable energy, support of Aboriginal people, and there are two other things that I can't remember. That may very well be a model of how we have to go. But let me tell you, we in the rich countries are setting the example for the rest of the world. I was at Kyoto in 1997. India, China, Indonesia, Brazil, they were all there too. And at Kyoto, everyone agreed. We in the rich countries had created the problem by our profligate use of fossil fuels. And therefore, it was our responsibility in the rich countries to cap and reduce our emissions so that by 2012, then the entire world would be brought under an agreement. As soon as Kyoto was over, Alberta and then all of Canada began to say, well, it's not fair. The Indians and Chinese aren't in there. And they've got rapidly growing economies. Wait a minute. They were there. We all agreed we had created the problem. If we in the rich countries, who are extravagantly wealthy, are not willing to cap and reduce our emissions, why should India or China or Brazil or any other country pay any attention to it? But of course, if they don't, begin to look to renewables, they'll bring the rest of the world down with them. But we are setting the example. We are the ones that have been profligate, and if we can't reduce our emissions, we're setting a very bad example.
Excellent. Vishwu is age 12, somewhere here in the room, which is great to have someone here that's that young and asking a superb question. And it really follows on from the last question. And it has to do with people in our society who aren't extravagantly wealthy. And given that, how do you convince people who aren't extravagantly wealthy to stop buying at stores such as Walmart and Dollarama when they're cheaper?
What can I say? I think that we need a society that understands you cannot have a sustainable way of life when there are such enormous inequities in the distribution of wealth. And so we've got to stop measuring success by the number of obscenely wealthy people in our society. A measure of success for our country is by the state of our weakest, most vulnerable, our poorest people. That is a measure of how successful we are. And I went to school in the United States from 1954 to 1962. I got an education there I couldn't get anywhere else in the world. Sputnik was fired up in 1957, and the Americans began a massive program to catch up to the USSR. I was a Canadian living in the States, but they didn't care. If you said, I like science, they threw money at you. It was a glorious time, and I was offered all kinds of jobs without even soliciting them, but I decided I wanted to come home to Canada, because Canada, to me, meant the CCF and Tommy Douglas. Canada meant Medicare, the National Film Board, the CBC. Canada meant equalization payments from the rich provinces to the poorest provinces. Canada represented something different from the United States and something I preferred to come back to live in. And Canada, I'm afraid, is becoming a country I don't recognize from the one that I moved back for in 1962. We've got to rediscover that Canada. Who are we? What are we proudest of? We've got to begin that discussion. I am sure it is not about having banks that haven't screwed us to the wall. It's not about having a balanced budget. There's something higher than that as far as Canadians are concerned. And I think part of that is that we care about the vulnerable people, that we want to share, that we don't look at these obscene levels of wealth, that we tax the hell out of those people so that we can share with the rest. There is no way I'm going to be able to answer all of these questions. Please stop bringing any more down here.
There's some general themes. Some that are humorous, actually, but I think we'll it's not for a general audience.
Someone's going to give me a testosterone shot.
There is a good one. Would you consider running for political office?
I'm 70. I'm going to be 76 this month. Not a chance.
There's a general feeling among some of the questions about pessimism. We're in this rapid phase of growth. We have an imbalance of perspective on ecology versus the economy. What are the hopeful messages that you would give?
You know, I'm enough of a scientist. I can see all the trend lines. The oceans are being depleted. We're changing the chemistry of the atmosphere. The land is polluted and being deprived of forests. I mean, you can see the data. It's crystal clear that we are on a destructive rampage. Many people I admire enormously are saying it's too late, that we've passed too many tipping points. The Royal Astronomer of England, Sir Martin Rees, was asked on BBC recently, what are the chances human beings will survive to the end of this century? And his answer shocked me. He said 50-50. James Lovelock, who coined the expression Gaia to describe all life on Earth, says that by the end of this century, 90% of humanity will be gone. And Clive Hamilton, an eco-philosopher in Australia, a man I really respect, who wrote the book Affluenza in the 1990s, has just written a book called Requiem for a Species. And guess what species it's a requiem for? It's us. My response to these people is thank you for the urgency. Your message is one of urgency. Now, please go away and shut up. There is no purpose served by saying it's too late. And I don't believe we know enough to say it's too late. And let me tell you why. This is not just optimism for optimism's sake. There's nothing Pollyanna-ish in this. The largest run of sockeye salmon in the world is in the Fraser River in British Columbia. The sockeye are the most prized salmon species in the world. And 2 years ago, a run which should be up around 30 to 40 million animals was reduced to just over 1 million. And I said to my wife, that's it. They've had it. They've passed too many tipping points. They've gone. 1 year later, we got the biggest run of sockeye in 100 years. Now, I don't want to say that to show how stupid I am. Nobody knows why that sudden change. But it gives me the hope that nature has secrets up her sleeve. If we can back off and give nature a chance, maybe she will be far more forgiving than we deserve. And so that's the hope that I cling to.
We have a question here from a UTSC Drosophila geneticist.
Whoa.
That's Mark Fitzpatrick. And Mark asks, you've talked to us about what it is that youth can do today. What is it that educators can do today?
Well, I think the challenge now, and something that our foundation is trying to do, is develop a core curriculum from K to 12 that is focused on eco-literacy. So that doesn't mean, you know, a course on environmentalism from K to 12. It means that looking at the world through the lenses of environmentalism has to suffuse every aspect of our education, whether it's mathematics or history or what. We have to have that environmentalist lens that has to be much more biocentric. And I hope we can develop a curriculum. And we're talking about putting it on the internet so that people can go to that and get educated. But I think this is a real challenge, is that we have to make a transition from an anthropocentric worldview to a biocentric one. Because if we're stuck in the anthropocentric, we are doomed.
Is that a message that carries over to post-secondary education institutions like UTSC?
Well, sure, of course, of course. But you know, I've always decried, ever since I got to the University of British Columbia, the fact that the two great streams of the arts and sciences in our universities are treated as if they're completely separate. It's possible for a UBC graduate in science to take maybe one Mickey Mouse token course in the arts throughout 4 years of university. They graduate as ignorant savages. Ignorant, and that, I don't mean to insult savages when I say that. They're ignorant. They're ignorant about the great forces of history, of philosophy, of some of the great art and music. They're ignorant of these great things in human society. And it's the same thing with arts. You can graduate with an arts degree having had one token course in science. And you are ignorant about the most powerful force that is shaping society and life today. And that is science, when applied by industry, medicine, and the military. And the great separation of those two great streams of human thought is one of the greatest tragedies, I think, in higher education. But I'm reflecting my bias. I graduated with a Bachelor of Arts degree with an honors in science, but I was never allowed to take more than 40% of my courses in science from freshman year on, even though I'm honored in science. And I think that's the way it should be.
A question that is appearing in multiple venues here has to do with Rio 2012, and very much in keeping with our co-host this evening, We Canada. Javier Yebenis asks, you mentioned that all past environmental summits failed. Do you think that there's any hope for Rio 2012, and what might we hope to get out of it?
It just keeps the issue percolating. But I've seen too many of these, and this may be a reflection of my age, to feel that this is going to somehow trigger a major change. I think that what is going to impel us is a prolonged catastrophic event that is undeniably caused by ecological collapse. But I don't. All I look forward to at Rio Plus 12 is to keep the issues being raised at least for a week, maybe.
Related to that, do you see any political or technological solutions to the mess that we're in?
I don't think, you know, we are at a stage now where some of the leading climatologists say that if we want to avoid catastrophic runaway climate change of above 2 degrees Celsius in the next century, we have to keep carbon concentration in the atmosphere below 350 parts per million. We're already at 389, and we're on our way to 450. And people are now saying we've got to keep it below 450. I think we're already in. There's nothing we can do to what we've added. We're in for very difficult times.
Carbon capture and storage?
They're now talking about geoengineering, you know, putting umbrellas in space to shade the sun so it doesn't hit, you know, or painting the surface of the earth somehow white to reflect. And of course, the big one is geoengineering. Our government is not doing a goddamn thing to seriously reduce our emissions, but we are investing billions in carbon capture and sequestration. Now, this comes about because when the oil industry has a well that is being depleted, they know if they inject carbon dioxide under pressure, that will result in the extrusion of more oil, so they can get more oil out of a depleted well. And the carbon dioxide doesn't come back. So wow, isn't that perfect? We just have to pump carbon dioxide into the ground and it'll stay out of sight, out of mind. But wait a minute now. Up until a few years ago, we thought there was no life below bedrock. And then they started finding that the bits that went down deeper and deeper kept getting contaminated with organisms. And scientists began to look at that seriously. And guess what? We find life down 6-7 miles below the surface of the earth. These creatures, they're bacteria, are so different from anything we know above ground that we have to create whole new phyla. And if you know anything about nomenclature of living organisms, phyla are just below kingdoms. Kingdoms, phyla. These are like finding creatures that came from Mars. We know nothing about them. But if we look, they go 7 miles down, and that goes right around the Earth. The weight of living protoplasm under the ground is greater than the weight of living protoplasm above ground. That's all the fish, the whales, the trees. There are less protoplasm above. We know nothing about these creatures. What do? Are they part of the energy cycle, water cycle, nitrogen cycle? What the hell are they doing down there? And when you pump carbon down there, what happens to it? So I asked one of the world's leading authorities on microorganisms underground, Tullis Onstott at Princeton University. He came to a lecture I gave. I said, Tullis, they're going to pump millions of tons of carbon into the ground. What'll that do? He said, I have no idea. But the methanogens will love it. I said, what are they? These are bacteria that take carbon dioxide and convert it into methane, which is 22 times more potent a greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. Boy, are we smart. What happens to that carbon dioxide when you pump it underground? Well, a lot of it is captured under limestone that acts and keeps the carbon as a bubble. Carbon dioxide in water forms carbonic acid, and carbonic acid etches limestone. So we're pumping carbon into the ground, and it's being stored by under a cap of limestone. That carbon is going to etch its way through that limestone cap and be liberated. This is, when we know so little, I think it's insane to think that we're not going to just solve things by pumping it underground. We've got to stop burning fossil fuels and get on to renewable energy as fast as we can.
Excellent answer. Now, one...
Can we answer one more? And then
one more question, and it's the perfect one. I've seen it on a number of cards now, and it strikes me as a stereotypical question for an undergraduate to ask. What is the take-home message from your talk this evening?
It's your future as young people. It's your future that we're talking about. And right now, our so-called leaders in business and government are not showing any indication they care what happens to your future. You think about political vision, it at most extends from one election to the next. What politician is going to take the steps to seriously address the matter of climate change, which we know is going to cost tens and tens of billions of dollars to cap and reduce our emissions, and it'll take 15 to 20 years to bring this down seriously. What politician is going to do that? They know they're going to catch shit from the public if they say, I'm going to start spending $10 billion a year, and maybe in 20 years, we're going to see the benefit. They know they're not going to be in office 10 or 15 years down the line. Why should they do something now and let some politician in the future maintain a benefit from that? Business people are looking at the quarterly report to determine what they do. Do you think they give a damn about something 20 or 30 years down the line? Your futures are in the balance. And that's why you have no choice but to get up and start making a lot of noise. And thank you for doing that. I, as an elder, will be there, and so will a hell of a lot of your elders. Let's get up and make a noise and demand some action.
Before I turn things over to Franco Vaccarini, just want to make one comment, and that is, there will be a book signing just down the hallway in the meeting place. For those of you who are going to hang around, you can see Dr. Suzuki there. I'm going to turn things over to Franco Vaccarini in a second, but before I do, is there anybody here in the audience who's 17 years old? Anyone? Oh, a whole bunch of people up in the back. The reason I want to center you out for a second, because 33 years ago, a mother in Cambridge, Ontario, took their 16, 17-year-old son down the road to Guelph, Ontario, to see a lecture by this gentleman. And that lecture was so inspiring that that individual went on, pursued a career in genetics, and really attempted to do things in reaching out to people and help them understand the environment. And 33 years later, ended up on this stage interviewing this man. And I hope that those of you who are 17 or any age here this evening take as much inspiration from Dr. Suzuki as I've taken in my life and really go out and try to make a difference. Thank you, Dr. Suzuki.
Okay, just a couple of quick points. First of all, let me take this opportunity to personally thank Dr. Suzuki for an absolutely inspirational, thought-provoking, and also, I have to say, a message of hope. I know that I speak for everyone here and everyone at UTSC when I say what a delight and privilege it's been to have you here. And we've heard that you were here 27 years ago. And I'm sure your message has evolved and changed over time, but the one thing that you have absolutely done is you have made sure that we keep our eye on this ball. And, you know, we're creatures of habituation, and it's easy to desensitize to these issues. And it's really people like yourself, and in particular your message, that's made sure that we don't desensitize and keeping our eye on the ball. Now, In the spirit of you having been here 27 years ago, now you remember that Dr. Suzuki mentioned that 27 years ago, his hair was darker, The key word there is hair. He actually, 27 years later, he still has hair. But what we have here, is certainly I can't relate to, but what we have here is a special memento that I'd like to present on behalf of UTSC to Dr. Suzuki of his lecture back then. And I got to tell you, he hasn't changed. I mean, his hair color has changed a bit. So whatever he's eating, you know, we got to get it. Now this concludes the formal part of the as you heard, there's a book signing opportunity. I'd also like to mention again, thanks to We Canada. We Canada has asked me to put in a plug for this hat. It's got a Leafs. Maybe it's a good luck thing for the Maple Leafs in the future. They're selling these hats. A little bit of fundraising and to help out We Canada. So please do that. Where are they? In the back? Is it? Oh, they're outside. So thank you again for coming. There's a book signing. Support We Canada. Terrific job. Thank you very much.